Where's Judy?
Making coffee, Mr. Demonicus.
Oh, well, I'll be gone for about an hour, okay?
Have you had any calls from that girl? Any sign of her?
No.
A bit of a worry, isn't it?
It's a bit late in the day for you to start getting conscientious, eh? Any problems?
No.
You better get the car ready.
Sure, Mr. Demarcus.
Who was that boy?
Just a boy, I know.
You look absolutely terrified. What is it?
That's the boy.
The one from the school. I thought you'd put the lid on all of that.
So did I.
What's he doing here?
Will you stand by me?
Haven't I so far?
Yeah, but I think I'm going to need some more help.
Why, what's the matter?
He came here to warn me that his father's looking for me.
That could be uncomfortable for you.
His father's on the police force. He's dangerous. He wants to kill me. So what do you think, Mr. Demonicus? I mean, obviously, I don't want any trouble here that might embarrass you in any way.
No.
No. I mean, ideally, if I could get away for a while. But the only thing is, I'm broke. If you could help me financially, I mean, I think you'll agree. I've given you good service here for a long time. If you could help me through this difficult period.
Good morning, Mr. Demonicus.
Ah, Jenny.
Can I bring another car?
No. I'm just leaving. Thank you. I think we can come to some arrangement. It just seems impossible to comprehend.
How long had you known him, Mr. Demonicus?
Oh, about 18 months, perhaps a little bit more.
He worked here all that time?
Part-time until just recently, yes.
A part-time? He had another job then?
He was a school teacher, I think. All that was rather vague.
You got a note?
Yeah.
The irony is that today was to be his last day here for some time. He was going on holidays.
Was he married?
No.
Girlfriends?
No. I've read about these recent bashings. Do you think they're...
We'll be following up all lines of investigation. What time did he leave here tonight?
I'm not sure. Jenny could tell you. Jenny Tarrant. She's the other assistant. Would you like her address?
Please.
I have it here.
Did Mr. Kavanagh have any particular problems?
I knew very little about his private life, Sergeant. Again, Jenny may be able to help. That's her address there.
Well, that's a telephone number. May I?
Yes, please.
You live on the premises, Mr. Demonicus?
Yes, I have a flat upstairs. Would you like to come up, have a drink or something?
No, thank you.
I could do with one after this, I can tell you.
I've got a note of Kavanagh's home address, but do you happen to know of any relatives, friends, or acquaintances that we should check out?
No, I'm sorry, I can't help.
We have reason to believe that Mr. Kavanagh had some rather vital information for us. Do you know anything about that?
No, I can't possibly imagine what it would be, no.
It's a bummer. Miss Tarrant is spending the night with friends. Her landlady didn't know where or who.
What time does Miss Tarrant normally get here in the morning?
She always arrives just before 9.
You be here then, check this out?
Sure.
Right, thank you, Mr. Demarcus.
Sorry, I can't be of more help, gentlemen.
That seemed to be all they wanted to know, Mr. Demarcus.
Well, as long as you helped them all you could.
Of course.
That's good. Jenny, why don't you pack up and take the rest of the day off? You must feel awful.
Yes, I do.
Well, go on. Pack up. Go home.
You're very kind.
Jenny is very upset. I've told her to close up and go home.
Lookers, come back.
Kathy, we were expecting you yesterday morning.
Yes.
And you didn't arrive. I want to hear all about that. Ah, Kathy. Are you rested?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Demonis.
Ah, sit down. I didn't want to weary you with all sorts of questions when you first arrived this morning.
Thanks.
But now it is time for an explanation.
Yes.
Well?
Well, I mean, everything's all right. Nothing went wrong.
Oh, good. But you were supposed to arrive here the day before yesterday.
Yes.
You had an obligation.
I know.
You've been with us for about 6 months now, Kathy, haven't you? And I think you would agree that you found it quite profitable, huh?
Yes.
Yes, and we all agreed on three very important aspects. Punctuality, reliability, and secrecy, didn't we?
Yes.
Yeah? So where have you been for the last 48 hours? I want to know now and in every detail.
Nothing went
wrong. Of course something went wrong.
Well, nothing really.
What?
My dad found out I'd been missing school.
Oh! And naturally, he demanded an explanation, eh?
I didn't tell him anything.
Good girl, Kathy. Very good. So where have you been for the past 48 hours?
Well, I had to play it cool for a bit, you see. Until my dad lost interest.
Of course, very wise, very wise. So, where have you been?
Home.
All the time? You mean you never stepped out of your house for 48 hours? And then you came right here?
That's right.
Bailey, play that tape we recorded last night, huh?
Hello?
Dad.
I speak to Kathy, please. Who's that?
Just a friend. Is Kathy there?
You are.
I really need to talk to her quite urgently.
Well, that's too bad.
Aren't you a father?
So what?
If you've got any sense of responsibility, you must have some idea.
Don't talk to me about responsibility. I've been trying to find it since yesterday morning and so have the coppers.
Well, I didn't want to worry you, you see. I mean, well, because of everything, my dad took me down to the police station and they tried to ask me questions and to make me talk, but I didn't tell them anything, Mr. Demonicus. I ran away. I really did. You believe me, don't you? I didn't tell them anything.
Of course. Kathy, why don't you go and have a nice little shower and change into some fresh clothes and then we'll talk again, huh?
Okay, but you do believe me, don't you?
Of course.
Do you believe?
She lied about where she'd been.
But she could have been.
She lied, and once is all it takes, and now we have to get rid of her, Billy.
She's still in the shower.
You decided how you're going to do it, everything carefully planned.
She's just a kid.
Oh, scruples, Billy.
Using these kids is one thing. Killing them?
Perhaps we can talk about some sort of bonus.
It's not the money. How much more killing is it going to be?
I don't know. Do you want to get out?
I'd get a long way, wouldn't I? Get as far as Kavanagh.
Kavanagh became a great risk. You agreed?
Yes.
Yes, and you dealt with him?
Yes.
Yes.
Seems different somehow. We're talking about a 14-year-old kid.
No, we're not. We're talking about a very lucrative business which I have set up here and which you are only too anxious to enjoy the profits of. We are talking about how that business has now been placed in jeopardy because of the irresponsibility of a grubby little 14-year-old tart. Now, you better get yourself in shape.
What's the matter?
Oh, no!
You had quite a lot, didn't you, Kathy? Eh?
I didn't tell the cops anything.
No, you did.
Somebody's at the shop.
See who it is and get rid of them. I'll take care of the situation here. And Bailey, no matter who it is, get rid of them. This whole situation could come apart, the seams and us included. Now get rid of them.
I don't care whether he's a phony or not. I don't intend to wait around here and find out. We're blown, Bailey. Thanks to Kavanagh.
Thanks to her.
Thanks to anything. We've got to pull up stakes for a little while, you and me, and get out of here. As So unless you've got a ticket to Rio, you better tidy everything up first, right?
Where are we going?
I'll have this place clean in 1 hour. I've got $100,000 in my pocket. A fully stocked cabin cruiser waiting for us at Cannon Creek Pier. All the loose ends tied up. Except this one. And that's your job. Or do I have to do everything myself?
Cannon Creek?
Cannon Creek. Now get her into the car.
Sergeant Major, eh? I mean, it's a bit of a mouthful for a pretty wee lassie like yourself.
I'm also Mrs. Harry Sullivan, and my friends call me Lou.
Well, I'm Fergus McCullough. Is your husband away there?
No, he's here in Melbourne.
Oh, lucky man.
What part of Scotland are you from, Fergus?
Inverness-shire. You're none the wiser, are you?
Clean, Mark.
Oh, I must have got some photographs here if you'd like
to
look.
I'd love to see them.
Sergeant Taylor phoned me. He said he wanted to talk to me.
Oh, you're happy, please, sir.
You don't seem very upset at being robbed, Mr. Peck.
Well, would it help your investigation if I started to rant and rave?
No, it wouldn't, and we appreciate your attitude. And I'm happy to inform you that we've caught the persons responsible and recovered the stolen goods.
Oh, good, then. There's nothing more for me to worry about, then.
We do have one problem.
What's that?
What exactly did you keep in your safety deposit box?
Oh, just personal documents of value to nobody else but me.
That isn't what we found.
I beg your pardon?
There were no documents, personal or otherwise, just $50,000.
You ask me to believe that somebody stole my security boxes so as they could fill them up with money?
We're not asking you to believe anything, Mr. Peck. We're simply saying that somebody put that money in the box. Nobody knew about it, not even the bank.
You checked this out, of course.
Yes, we have. And now we have to find out where the money came from.
Of course, I understand. I'll help you all I can, but I assure you it's not mine.
I would have contacted you about the robbery, Mr. Peck, but I knew the police would take care of it.
All the same, you could have phoned.
I'm sorry. I've had a very worrying time.
Oh, yes, of course, I understand. Must be quite a shock.
It is, and naturally, as manager, I feel responsible.
Yes, well, it's always the commander who must take the responsibility. As for myself, I feel embarrassed. You see, the police believe they'd find $50,000 belonging to me.
Yes, I heard about the money. I can't understand it at all.
You can't? Well, it is mine, Mr. Curtin, but I don't wish the police to know that. In business, as you well know, one can't afford to be dishonest, but at the same time, one can't afford to be entirely honest either, you understand?
Yes, quite.
Yes, well, let us assume that I have a perfectly good reason for not wishing the police to know that the money is mine. Just an assumption, of course.
Of course.
Well, what would happen to the money now?
Well, if they can't trace the owner, it would go into consolidated revenue.
And how would I be compensated for my loss?
If you're not prepared to claim the money, I don't see how you can be.
And not officially, I mean, but there must be some other way.
I don't follow you.
When I leased those security boxes, you promised me absolute discretion.
Yes, that is so.
Yes, but it hasn't been so. There's been a leak of information. Someone found out about the money.
It was a robbery. An accident. They chose those particular boxes. Look, unless you're prepared to claim the money officially, there's nothing I can do to help you.
No? I wonder if it was an accident or whether it was carelessness. In either case, as you yourself remarked, you're responsible. Mr. Yu, I look to see that my money is returned.
What do you mean?
You heard, I think.
I haven't got $50,000 or anything like it.
No, but you will have, Mr. Curtin. And you'll see that I get it back. Otherwise, you'll be in trouble with the bank, with the police, and with me. Now, you understand? Al? Yeah, Lawrence here. Listen, I've run into a little bit of trouble down here. Is Schaefer available? Oh, good. Yeah, tomorrow will be fine. Listen, tell him to phone me as soon as he reaches the city, and I'll arrange that he gets the right equipment to do what is needed.
She'll be worth an each way bet.
The principle of each way betting disgusts me, Schaefer. See, winning is my only vice.
You haven't changed then, Mr. Peck?
No.
What do you want me for?
There's been a bank robbery. One which I never planned or approved of. And it's embarrassed me to the tune of $50,000, which the police are now holding.
That can buy a lot of embarrassment.
Yeah, it's a branch of the Federal Bank in Station Street. The bank manager's name is Kern, and his accountant's called Lang.
An inside job?
It has to be. What I want to know is which one organized the robbery or whether it was both.
And then?
And then? You can assure me of the return of my money. I'll be the same again when you've completed your task. Successfully.
No each way bets.
That's right.
Killing me won't get your money back, Mr. Peck. Just give me time. I'll make it good.
I'm not interested in money. I'm interested in you.
What do you mean?
You see, I want to make an example of you. Then perhaps in future, collecting my debts will be a lot easier. Hmm?
You can't kill me and get away with it.
Move out to the car, Mr. Curran.
Drop it, Schaefer!
Look, I'm often in the track at this time, on business.
Depends what the business is, doesn't it, Mr. Peck? Let's go.
Well, I was just passing, and I wondered if the doctor was in.
He won't be until lunchtime, I'm afraid.
Ah, I see.
Is there anything I can do?
Well, I actually wanted to have a wee chat with the good doctor. You see, it's a matter of some, well, some delicacy, you see.
Is it very urgent, Mr. Oak?
Well, it's not exactly urgent, but then again, something has to be done and pretty soon.
Oh, I see.
You see, it's Jimmy Joyce here. I'm afraid he's, well, his hormones, I'm afraid they're going to be the finish of him.
Oh?
Yeah, well, you see, he's not a young cat anymore, and when he goes out in the out in the tiles, so to speak, he runs into all these young buckos trying to well, sort of lay claim to his territory, if you know what I mean. Anyway, he's just not up to it anymore, and I'm afraid that his brain's going to become a wee bit addled if he keeps it up, and not to mention the the wear and tear in the other parts too. Anyhow, it basically sort of comes down to this. I was wondering if there was something we could do to reduce his interest in the and the opposite sex, if you know what I mean.
Well, there is an operation.
Oh, no. Not the knife. No. We couldn't face that, could we, Jimmy? No. I wouldn't want to deprive him completely. I mean, it's one of his very few pleasures. No, I was thinking more along the lines of, you know, sort of turning the throttle back a wee bit, you know, sort of tempering his enthusiasm with a wee dab of decorum.
Well, I'm afraid the operation...
Well, you know, when I was in the army, they used to, they used to put something in our tea to stop us from running amok. And I was wondering if maybe we could be putting something in his milk.
Not that I know of, Mr. Rourke, but I really do think that you should be talking to Dr. Ramsey.
It's a terrible problem, I know, and I hope we can reach some sort of equitable solution. I mean, I wouldn't want him to lose his self-esteem. Not entirely, you know.
Well, if you could pop in tomorrow?
Yeah. It's a problem I wish I had myself sometimes. Yeah. Oh, aye. Right, okay, thanks, miss. Thank you very much indeed.
Dr. Ramsey will be back by then.
Oh, thank you. Come on then, Jimmy, come on. You need your rest.
Good morning.
Morning.
You must be...
Relieving Officer Jock Stewart.
Are we glad to see you.
Is Mrs. Davidson in?
Oh, yes, of course. Is she in her office, Wendy?
In the staff room.
Oh, well, I'll take you along and introduce you. Have you worked in women's prisons before?
As a matter of fact, no, I haven't.
Ladies, I want to introduce you to our new relieving officer, Mr. Stewart.
And what's your specialty, Mr. Stewart? Whips, thumbnails, or leather boots?
Don't get smart, lassie, and there'll be no hassles.
Oh, hi, Jock. Get right away.
The women's D-section are just about finished making up their own brew. Smells great.
Oh, God, I hope not. If the screws get wind of it, there will be a stick.
Wonder where they're stashed in the old storeroom in D-section.
But will you two shut up?
Mrs. Davidson, then?
Yes, but I don't know whether she wants to be disturbed.
I don't think she'll mind when she finds out what I've got to report. You see, I've just discovered something about a certain storeroom in D-block.
The ladies, eh? Hard getting them to make up their minds. We're serious, Dory. Real serious. This might be your only chance.
That's it for today. You know, with all the visitors you've been getting lately, you must be quite an important wee lady, hmm? I tell you, it makes a sweet change working in a woman's prison, I can tell you that. I heard what happened, and I'm sorry. I got suspended myself once, you know. And I don't like it. I don't like it at all. And I reckon it's about time something was done about it. Been checking up your file, Vincent. Drunk, prostitute. Killed a client for criticizing you. Miss Bennett criticized you too, didn't she?
She doesn't know anything about me or my work.
Well, she knew enough to like. I hope you don't tell the governor that. I'll see to it that you never paint again. Look, you're back. That's the main thing.
Yes. Well, I don't know how you did it, but thank you.
Just took a bit of detective work, that's all. Let's just say I think you should reconsider for your own sake.
You can't tell me what to do with things like that. I'll go and tell Mrs. Davidson.
I'll be back. else. Just let you pull yourself together.
You could always see I get a few of the comforts of home. And I'll keep quiet about what I just heard.
You know, I think you and I will go on just fine, Gilmore. Just fine. Dead.
What?
Well, she appears to have fallen down the stairs.
Well, who found her?
Miss Bennett and I were just returning from H Block when discovered the body lying in the stairwell.
Did you examine her?
Just briefly. There was no pulse, and by the way the body was lying, it looked like her neck was broken.
What do you think happened to Gilmore?
It's obviously an accident. Well, the police don't seem to share my opinion.
Well, it must be pretty difficult for them to make out a case either way. On the one hand, it could have been an accident. But after all that hullabaloo in the art class this morning, it seems like a rather convenient accident.
Ah, well, what difference does it make? Gilmore's dead, and we can't change that.
You don't seem very concerned.
Why should I be?
Well, if it wasn't an accident, it means one of the women killed her.
Then the police will catch them.
Rubbish. It was murder.
Well, they need proof, and all the officers say they saw nothing. They wouldn't be protecting anyone. Listen, I'll patrol isolation, if you like. And don't get yourself all upset about this. Look, Gilmer was a scum of the earth. Who cares how she died? Well, I mean, you're inside and he can't possibly help you, can he? Time's running out, Doreen. No, I don't want to hurt you. But if you don't make up your mind pretty shortly about selling that house, I just might have to use a wee bit of persuasion. I think it's about time you made up your mind to sell that house, There's no rush, of course. Tomorrow will do fine. But if you haven't made up your mind to sell by then, I might just have to give you a little push. The same as I did with Gilmore.
The girls call him the Highland Flinger.
Why?
Because that's how he gets his kicks. Flinging his fists about it.
All you have to do is just keep your mouth shut.
You knew my friend Sharon Gilmore, didn't you? She died on these stairs. She fell all the way down to the bottom. It was an accident, they said. And you and I know that that's not true, don't we, Mr. Stewart?
Good morning, Mr. Stewart. How was your meeting with Mr. Westmore last night?
Fine. You know Mr. Westmore, do you?
I didn't realize he delivered your mail to you. By the way, did he happen to mention whether or not he'd been able to acquire Burns's house?
No, he didn't. Look, I'd go and see the governor myself, but I've already been in front of a royal commission.
You were innocent, of course.
Of course. Of course I was. I was acquitted. But any more suspicion coming my way and I could lose my job.
Doreen's not that cheerful, Mr. Stewart.
Oh, that's a shame.
Yeah, she's been pushed around a bit lately.
Has she? By who?
We thought you might know that.
You're a quick man with a hard push, aren't you, Mr. Stewart? What did you do to Sharon?
What, this Bryant?
You know, no one was watching you. You didn't give her a chance, did you? All you did was give her a quick push from behind.
That's enough of that, Bryant.
I can have you transferred back to Pentridge. I shall put in my report to the department, and they can decide what to do.
Cite me, I suppose.
Well, if it isn't the lady killer. You weren't near those stairs, were you, Jock? Nowhere near those stairs when Sharon was killed. Murderer! Murdering bastard! I hope you're frying hell, you bloody butcher!
I have spoken to the department about you, Mr. Stewart. I have been instructed to relieve you of your duties immediately, pending an internal inquiry.
Condemned without a hearing, huh?
Oh, you will get your hearing. Your guilt is not our immediate concern, but your effect on Wentworth is. You seem unable to maintain discipline. My officers already have two women on report because of you.
That's hardly my fault, though, is it?
The service is only as strong as its weakest link.
I'm going to walk right out of here, free as a bird, forget the whole thing. But you, you're going to be locked up for a long, long time. Long enough to go start ravers. You see, I did kill her.
Yeah.
I did. You want to know why? Because she overheard me heavying Anderson. And then the silly little slut thought she was going to blackmail me. See you around, kid. It's been nice knowing you.
You lost something, Jock.
A job, I think.
What's happened?
Relieved of his duties, pending an internal inquiry.
How did that come about?
Guess the women needed some sort of scapegoat. Had to be me. Full internal inquiry, the whole box and dice. This is no job for a man. These sluts are out to nag you the minute you step in the door. And that's staff and crims, both of them. Still, why tell you? You've been through it yourself.
Yes, I must admit I've had a few problems.
I know. So long, Jimmy.
Good luck, Jock.
Thanks.
That I like to look after my special customers. If I'd known you were coming, Sally isn't here, you see.
Well, you better get somebody else, then.
Yes, of course. If you'd like to wait in there, I'll see you're well looked after.
Escaped. I thought you might have come after me. I didn't think you'd forget that very easily. Now it looks like I got you just where I want you, lassie. You know, I could kill you right now. Walk right out of that door and never lose a night's sleep. You know that?
Why don't you?
But it wouldn't be much fun in that, though, would there, eh? I'm a man who likes his pleasures, you know that. What I want, you couldn't possibly supply. I know what you are, Brian. You couldn't satisfy the likes of me. You wouldn't have a clue. But I tell you what you are going to do. You're going to work for Jock. That's right. Because every time I come in here, I'm going to want $300 from you. You understand? If you don't, I'll do two things. First of all, I'll break every bone in your body. That's right. And then I'll inform my friends, the boys in blue, that you and your wee friend, Helen Smart, are right here for the pickings. You'll both be whisked off to Wentworth in a flash. If you don't, you'll be sorry for the day you ever heard the name Jock Stewart. Poor wee Sharon Gilmer. Eh? You remember her, eh? Pretty wee thing, too. I remember her all lying crumpled at the bottom of these stairs. You're gonna have to offer your client something more than just a wee gentle rub down, aren't you, eh? Or can you manage that, eh? I'm gonna be in here every day. I'm gonna want my money. I mean, after all, I deserve it. Why don't you be nice to old Jock, eh?
You've got to be kidding. No, that's not part of the deal.
Sharon Gilmer was nice. She was very nice. I mean, one dyke's as good as another.
You bastard, you
please, hang on the table. Right, you're both under arrest.
For? I'm just having a little massage. There's no crime in that, is there?
Your name Jock Stewart?
It is, yeah. What about it?
Do you know what we just heard outside the door makes you and Judy Bryant here good mates?
Never seen it before in my life.
Oh, come on, Jock. You might as well tell them the truth. The game's up now.
Stinking rotten bitch. You sit down! Brett, go on! You're an ex-screw, aren't you? I've got news for you. I'm gonna throw the book at you. A quiet spell on the other side of the bars will be no picnic, will it?
I just want to say one thing to you, Jock. This one was for Sharon. And I hope they kill you.
Come on.
Well, I'll have the sharpers lined up when you get back.
Harry, you remember the day that... fine-looking animal.
You know Mr. Maynard?
We've got mutual acquaintance. Actually, what I wanted to do was congratulate him on his win, but when I saw him with his family and all, I didn't want to butt in.
Oh, it wasn't quite his family. My young Jeff's his nephew. And the others were Jeff's missus and his mother-in-law.
No, I would have butted in any case, just to say hello, you know? Hello, Mr. Maynard. My name's Andrew McLeod. I'm a friend of Jeff's from up north.
Oh, yeah?
Look, I've been in New Zealand a couple of years. I heard he was stopping with you, is that right?
Well, no, he's in town on his honeymoon.
Oh, so he did marry her?
Oh, you know Laurie?
Well, not really, but he wrote to me about her. I wonder if you could help me contact him. I didn't want to bust in on his honeymoon, but I've only got a couple of days left before I go back to New Zealand.
Oh, I can't see any harm in that. They're staying with Laurie's mum. Hang on a minute, I'll get you the address.
Good.
Oh, g'day.
Small world, isn't it, Lizzie?
Get out of this car before I scream my lungs out.
Oh, I don't think I'd do that, Lizzie. I mean, I'm not causing any harm. Just a passenger. Just want a bit of your time, that's all. You can even start the meter going if you want.
Just say what you have to say and get out.
I've been having a pretty hard time since I came out to Pendridge. Very difficult making ends meet.
It's your fault, isn't it?
I don't see it that way, does it? I think it's your fault. Seeing how it is, I'm going to give you a chance just to make amends.
Really? You can't get blood out of a stone, can you?
You've got a daughter, haven't you? She just married a nice, upright young man. His uncle just happens to be a pretty well-heeled man of property. And we're coming through.
Why do you have to drag Arch and Jeff into this?
The reason why I want to drag them in is that I need a wee loan, say about $5,000, just to get me started off afresh. I think you can convince Uncle Arch to help me out there, don't you? You're smart, right? You always were. That's how I know you'll get that money for me. Otherwise, I'll tell that wee daughter of yours and her husband. Her mother used to work for me in the massage parlor. Turning tricks at $20 a throw. Hi.
G'day.
I'm Fred Kavanagh from Battle and Evans.
Sorry for that.
The estate agent. Oh. I'm the maintenance man. This won't take very long. It's just that the previous tenants complained that there were some cracks in the plaster that needed filling and painting over.
I can't say we've noticed any.
Would you mind then if I had a wee look around?
No, go for your life, mate.
Thank you. I can't see anything wrong. Just proves you can't believe everything you hear, eh?
It was a bloody stupid thing to do, leaving that note. What if my daughter had found it?
She'd only think you're meeting a bloke in the park, that's all.
What do you want? I've already told you I can't help you.
Better not mean that, Brian. Otherwise, you're in real trouble. I want that money in 48 hours. Otherwise, your wee family's gonna find out all the gruesome details of your sordid past.
How to kill you.
You tried that once already, Brian. You weren't very successful. Now, I don't think Kiln's exactly in your line.
Don't you bet on it.
Oh, I haven't. That's why I've taken out that extra insurance policy. See, if anything at all happens to me, there's a letter goes right away to that son-in-law of yours and his uncle. I want a copy to the police force, too.
Who is it?
Yeah.
Jeff?
Yeah.
God, what's wrong? Oh! Here, get out!
It's a nice way to treat your old friend Jock. Only come over here to keep you company. Seeing as how your daughter's gone away now.
It's just... You bastard!
Yeah, now you don't, Brian.
Kill you!
Remind me of the time you tried to stick me with a knife, eh? You didn't do too well enough, did you, got blamed? Hey! Come on, try it! You bloody bitch!
Oh, my God!
Try it! Try it!
Oh, my God.
I'll be over tomorrow to get that money. Maybe you can be nice to old Jock again, huh? Don't get any ideas of double-cross me, Brian.
If you don't get that money, lovely Laurie is going to meet with a nasty accident.
She's in Queensland. You can't touch her.
You must think I'm a real fool, Brian. You know how long it took me to find out your address that day after the trots, don't you? Wouldn't take me more than about, 10 minutes to find out her address in Queensland. She's quite a spunky-looking little lady.
You bastard!
Yeah, get that money. I'll do a pay visit to that wee daughter of yours.
Hi there, Mr. Stewart.
What's this? Hidden witnesses? You're getting devious, Brian. Very devious.
I suggest you leave this place now and never come back. The police will be very interested in what I just overheard.
You must be a very brave woman, Mrs. Morris. Because I know you're not a fool. I could get rid of the two of you right here and now. No one would be any the wiser.
Pentridge must have been a breeze for you last time. Locked in isolation, away from all the other prisoners who hated you. I wonder what sort of treatment you'll get next time when they find out you've killed a fellow prison officer.
No! Oh!
Give me a drink. Get! By now, I suppose you're wondering what I'm going to do to you, Brian. Well, I'm going to hurt you. I'm going to hurt you real bad. Just to teach you a lesson. Of course, now that Meg Morris has stuck her nose in, I have to shoot through after I've done it. Because she'll inform the police as soon as she finds out where you are. I might even look up little Laurie for you, eh? You'd appreciate that. Well, you're recovering in hospital, wouldn't you, eh? Getting a letter from Laurie saying how she'd run into your old friend, Jock Stewart.
You evil bastard! You'll never hurt Laurie, you evil bastard! I'll kill you! I'll never think of that!
Jimmy, bloody mistake!
For God's sake. For God's sake, Bride, please help me.
Please, I can't move.
At least call an ambulance. Please, I can't move. Oh, please, I can't move. Oh, please, please. Oh, please, Brian. Please, I can't move. Please.
We go down to the Low Country and earn the right to live up here.
I wonder if we might have a few minutes of your time.
Who are you?
Jennifer Carson.
Oh, a solicitor. And what the hell do you want?
I represent Mr. Maxwell.
Oh, that idiot. Oh, well, that explains it.
And Mr. Maxwell wishes to press charges against you for an alleged assault.
Alleged is right. But I'll tell you something, madam. You're giving me good grounds for assaulting someone right here and now. So unless you and your friend are off my property in 2 minutes, I'll make sure that you regret the day that you ever heard of the name of Mr. Maxwell.
Don't threaten us, Captain Robinson.
Go on, get out.
We're just leaving.
You better do it. I'll set my wee dogs on to you. I wanted to invite you over to my home to apologize. Just as well you left your wee card, eh?
Well, it's certainly given us another opportunity to talk.
It has that.
You will discuss Mr. Maxwell's claim.
All right, fire away. Let's hear what the blathering idiot's been up to this time.
Mr. Maxwell alleges that you've pushed him down the veranda steps with no provocation.
Spreading his fairy stories again, is he?
He does have bruises to back up his story.
Well, he didn't come by them by me, I can assure you of that. I'm the kind of a man that likes to keep himself to himself. I mean, I might have a wee drink now and then by way of a celebration, but I'm not a violent man. Look, I'll tell you something about that Reg Maxwell. He's not all he seems to be. I think he's a wee bitty touched.
In what way, Captain?
Well, he's always dreaming up all sorts of injuries to himself and to his property. I tell you, the neighbours all round here are thoroughly sick of him. I tell you, the man's a wee bitty soft in the head. Of course, it's up to you who you choose to believe, him or me.
I'd like you to handle for me. She shouldn't be too hard to find. She's running out of places to go.
I know her. She's a lovely girl.
Same deal.
I'm gonna be run off my feet. Still, there hasn't been a great deal of work recently, so I don't suppose I should complain. Another drink?
No, thanks. In a bit of a rush.
It's a pleasure doing business with you.
This is...
An unexpected pleasure.
I was about to say it's a little early in the day.
Well, I've been doing some night work. I thought perhaps you might be able to help me unwind.
Yes, well, come upstairs. We'll have a drink.
That'd be real nice.
Mrs. Hanrahan, is it?
Heard you're looking for me. What's he done this time?
What's who done?
Dixie, my husband.
3535.
Well, they're not in there. And there's a woman in there, a secretary or something. I don't know where they are. Look, ring her. She'll get a message to them.
Thank you.
is a perfectly logical thing. Now listen. Oh. G'day.
Shut up.
Mind by the skewer?
Shut up.
Yeah, that's a better idea.
Shut up.
Now, Victor sent us to talk to you two. Where were you today? You didn't pick nothing up.
Yeah, we haven't had time. We've got a lot on. Look, we're no use to Victor. Why doesn't he get something?
Shut up! Listen, we're working on an international case.
Shut up.
He oversees a fair bit from now on, yeah.
You were lucky to catch
us. Shut up!
We're out of that line of work from now on.
Shut up!
It was very good work, actually. Very
shut
good
up! Oh. Oh.
Oh! Me.
Victor says number one, no subcontract. You took on the job, you make the deliveries, right? Number two, no women. Especially no women that Victor hasn't already seen.
What are you talking about?
I don't know, but I agree with it.
Now, you two mongrels, do exactly as we tell you, or we'll wipe you right out. End of story, okay?
Sure, yeah, I understand.
Now, wake up to yourself. Victor says jump. Jump!
What the hell was all that about?
I don't know.
Shaking him off?
We're not supposed to be shaking him off. We're following the people in front of him. You moron.
Have you met Neville?
We're a bit pushed for time, Neville.
Oh, there.
G'day, Neville.
Would you like another biscuit, Neville?
No, thanks, Pat. Victor wants to have a little chat with these two, gentlemen. When you're ready.
Yeah, we were just on our way around here.
That's a shot.
If Bill Martin rings, tell him there's a meeting at his place at 9 o'clock.
Thanks for the coffee, Pat.
Neville here saw Detective Sergeant Blair walking out of your office this afternoon.
Blair?
Blair?
Blair, is he a cop?
He's not, is he?
Blair,
he's an encyclopedia.
Shut up! Now listen to me. If you've told him anything, you're dead. Stand up. Go. Neville, make sure they don't get out of that car. And Neville, don't park too near it yourself.
You, read the Sunday paper?
Yes. It's a sick world, Neville.
Bastards.
I'll call the boys off. We're not going to dirty our hands. They do not exist. They are scum.
Simpson? Simpson?
Inspector Kevin Day, Robert Freeman.
Ah, from George's neck of the woods, eh? Jack Carruthers' country. How's our man looking after you up there, anyway?
Fine. Apart from the youth problem.
Oh, that's right. School holidays. I forgot about that. That's right.
I wish it was just that, mate, but I came under attack in my own car just yesterday. The situation's getting out of hand, I reckon.
You make it sound as if it's Soweto.
Perhaps you could get up there a little more often and see what really goes on.
You're not suggesting that Jack Carruthers isn't doing his job properly, are you?
A telephone call for you.
What would you like?
Surprise.
Just watch that circus. Do you think you're running up here, Jack?
Circus? What do you mean, sir?
I just got run off the road with a couple of young hoods driving something that looked like it just came out of a Mad Max movie.
Oh, well, that wouldn't be local, sir. No, we've got a nice bunch of kids up here.
Yeah, well, it's not what I heard.
Well, this very moment, sir, they're toiling on a self-help project, you know, a gymnasium, which I helped get started. I'd like you to see it. You would like to see it, wouldn't you?
I do not believe this.
Go for it!
Oh. Follow me.
All right, get after them.
Yes, sir. I know who they are, sir. I'll be able to pick them up from their homes.
I expected to find a problem up here, Carruthers. But I did not expect to find utter and complete bedlam.
Hey, hold it. Well, Inspector, this is a pleasant surprise.
Is it, Vic? Nancy? Folks?
Your annual visit is usually around race meeting time.
Just a bit of unexpected business, that's all, Nancy.
Well, wouldn't be anything serious, not in Cooper's Crossing.
Not with Jack Carruthers in charge. Runs a tight ship, old Jack.
And work, he's always at it, isn't he?
Yeah, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I used to think we pilots had it tough.
One of nature's gentlemen, old Jack.
I know when I'm being snowed, Vic.
What do you mean?
It won't work this time, mate. This time there's been too many serious complaints made by the locals.
Who?
Never mind. The fact of the matter is Jack Carruthers has passed it, and he's moving on.
Michael, tell me once when I've lied to you.
You lied, all right. You lied by omission. You told me how this disease was going to kill Mum, but you never told me it was going to kill me, too. I don't want to talk anymore.
Over and out.
Michael, it's Jack here, mate, Jack Carruthers. Now, you listen, it's not the motor. It's the elevator cable. It's chafed, and it could snap at any minute. Michael, you remember that time years ago when you and Swampy were into letting down tyres, and I caught him at it? I did everything to try and get the other names out of him, and I knew one of them was you, but he wouldn't tell me a thing. He was loyal to his mates. He was a mate, you know that. And the only reason he's told me that it's you up in that plane is because he knows it's unsafe.
Charlie, Cooper's Crossing's the nearest strip I put down there.
Jay, word with you, mate. Look, I'd like this minor indiscretion of young Michael's overlooked, all right?
He stole on an aeroplane, George.
Yeah, but it was my aeroplane and I won't be laying charges.
George, you're the one that wanted me to practically jail kids for just skylarking about in the streets. Now, Michael's overstepped the mark. He's broken the law. He's going to have to face the music.
Do you have any thoughts on this matter, Kev?
I have, George. From what I've seen in the past few hours, I've come to the conclusion that the people of Cooper's Crossing are a far better sergeant than some of them deserve. Seriously, Jack, when I saw those kids mucking up, I thought you were past it. I was going to have you moved on. But you handled the situation very, very well indeed. You'll do me, mate.
Thanks, Kevin.
Got all day.
Elvis McGinnis. Can't say I'm glad to see you.
Oh, you're safe, Athol. I'm a dry cleaner now.
That makes a difference.
I'm after some information on Noel Pomeroy.
Prick.
You care to add to that?
Biggest prick in the universe.
He's dead.
Axton.
Yeah, he accidentally smashed his head into a wheel brace half a dozen times.
Holy shit.
You know anyone apart from yourself who might want him dead?
Lads, did you hear? No Pomeroy just cocked it.
Thanks.
Mr. Fong?
That's right. It's a long story.
Right. We want to find out what you know about a greyhound called Mildura Lass.
Oh, good dog. Yeah, well, at least she used to be. Yeah, she'd be out in that box like a shot out of a gun. All the other dogs were just left standing there. No, she couldn't run out of sight in a foggy night.
Well, that's good news for you, though, isn't it?
Well, it's swings and roundabouts. I mean, there's always somebody who wants to bet on an outsider, just a chance that it might come in.
Listen, Ben, I think this is your show, isn't it?
That's right. Hey, make that a double scotch, no ice. Thanks, love.
So, any big bets in its last race?
I heard some of the bookies at Ballarat were laying off some big bets, yeah. You see, if someone comes along with, say, a couple of grand and they want to put it on at, say, 33 to 1, well, that's a lot of money to pay out if it comes in. So, thank you, love. So what they do is they sort of spread the risk out over several of the bookies.
Nobody's likely to bet that much on a dog that's lost form, are they?
Oh, they do. I took a couple of hundred off a mug punter just the other night.
On Mildura Lass?
Yep.
Well, do you know the punter in question?
I sure do. He's helped to put my kids through uni. Emmy Savage. DJ, how they hanging?
Not bad, Jimmy, not bad.
Good.
There's some big money floating out on a dog of Ballarat the other day.
Yeah, your mom was asking about Mildura Lass.
Yeah. What's the real story?
I told them what I know. Some guy was betting up big. $2,000, I hear.
Well, you made the bet, Jimmy. I would appreciate your help.
A guy called Marty Walker. And from what I hear, it's not like him to get it wrong.
Yeah, I don't know the name.
What the press like to call a colorful racing identity, originally from Sydney. Never mind the thanks. He has a double scotch, okay?
To the Kirks and the Kennedys.
Kirks and the Kennedys. Yeah.
Ah, you're nearly all Mr. Haggis. Oh, but anyhow, we're all yes, met well. Now. And the Haggis is ready. Now, Andrew, Stuart, a dram for everyone. And Ronald?
Yeah.
You may take the haggis.
Shaking already. You think they're going to see that under the kilt?
Yeah, listen, your flashes are too far around. Line them up with your arms.
Yeah, and the skin do over on the other leg.
Oh,
yeah.
To love, honour and cherish as long as we both shall live.
This is my solemn vow.
Gangaft a galeg. That's right, Fergus.
Aye, aye.
And we'll all go together to Bulwile.
See, my father owned a shop in the 60s, and he had the first wood fire oven in Australia. Unfortunately, Dad didn't really know how to use the oven. And while he was making a Mexican pizza, the oven exploded, and I got hot chili sauce all over my face and burnt out my retinas. I was only 5 at the time. Dad was killed.
Do you not understand? I've lost my ship. I'm ruined.
The laws of salvage will give you this ship. If you take me to the island, I'll make sure the Academy doubles your fee.
I'll remind you, we have nae compass.
But we have a navigator. Do we not, Mr. Morello?
A bit unusual, you could find insurance hard to come by. But at Shannon's, we know what they are, even Gogomobiles.
It's the dart.
And we know what they're worth.
A pretty penny.
Shannon's Insurance shares the passion with car enthusiasts.
Aye, and they give agreed value, choice of repairer, lifetime maximum, no claim bonus protection.
Your vehicle.
1300-139-006.
I was 16 when I first saw her. Loved her utterly. She was so sweet, so perfect. Still is. She's got a whopping great two-stroke engine under that gorgeous aerodynamic body. Insurance? Well, Shannon's, of course.
Shannon's. Insurance for motoring enthusiasts.
Is wanting fresh meat taste, but in the more convenience? Is wanting done, daring, supreme? It's carb fresh. Is done. Is good.
Want to taste sensation that's really new? Don Cheese Kransky is thing for you. Continental sausage with cheese in it. It's so much flavor, it has no limit. Go out and buy some. You really should, because you know very well his Don is excellent.
It's good!
Oh, it's nothing.
It's hot dog season. It's wanting Don skinless Frankfurts. It's Australia's top dog. Sorry. It's Australia's top hot dog. His dog is good.
His Don is good!
His dog is good, too.
Is Don Strasbourg is made old-fashioned way for genuine truths in the delicious taste. Is to be aware of cheap imitatings. Is Don is good.
Is pleased to be introducing two new taste sensations from Don. Hello, it's tasty tomato Frankfurt with real tomato.
Hello, it's tasty cheese Frankfurt with real cheese.
It's pleased to meet you.
It's pleased to meet you, too.
Is Don is good.
Don, white Hungarian salami, is authentical entertaining solution for everyone to enjoyment because he's not hot. He's mild. Is Don is good.